Hello, welcome to this lecture. We have been talking about energy at a kind of molecular level, like interaction between charges or atoms or molecules. But in biology, we would also have experiments where we may not be able to see all the atoms or the molecular details, but rather we would see some coarse-grained picture. For example, we could look biopolymers under a microscope. So you can have fluorescently labeled DNA or proteins like actin. So you have a long actin filament or microtubules. All of this can be fluorescently labeled, and you would see some configurations under a microscope, either in vitro or in vivo. And from these configurations, we want to know something about the energy of those configurations. So we are going to discuss in this lecture how to compute energy of biopolymer of certain configurations. So let me write here energy of biopolymers like actin, DNA or microtubule, or intermediate filaments, or it could be any biopolymer. So if you look under a microscope, for example, if you look actin under in a cell, like you would see some curve like this. That's what one would see for an actin if you look under a microscope, if you fluorescently label it, some many curves like this, right? So, or if you look at DNA, in the nucleus you would see like everything blue or some color. But if I can carefully have a small piece of DNA, then like it could look some shape like this. So it would look like some curve. If it is microtubule, it could look something like this. So if we look under a microscope all these biopolymers, we would see some curves like this. So based on this, that's all information we can get. We may not be able to get the molecular details from this kind of microscopy experiments. Now when I say microscopy experiments, certainly the lengths are much larger than like the wavelength, which is few hundred nanometers, right? So this would be like micron lengths or more than micron, right? That is the length of the curve that I have drawn here. Some of them, this is many microns, and this would be like a few microns, right? So that is the length of those curves. Now the idea to compute this energy is that one can represent this biopolymers as some curves in space. And there is a model to specify the energy, and that model is called the worm-like chain model. So let me write here, it's called worm-like chain model. So when I say the word model, in this context, it means that it specifies the energy. So this model, worm-like chain model, models the biopolymer DNA or actin, or this model can be applied to many biopolymers, all those biopolymers as some curves in space, and it specifies the energy. So the model always specifies the energy. Once we know the energy, we can compute various quantities from the energy, and we will discuss how to compute various quantities known energy. But this, let me specify the model first. The model just describes the energy of the system, and it considers this as some curve, like just like a filament you would have, like a cable. So in this particular, for this particular cable, we don't know all the molecular details, but we know its shape. So this is straight, this is like coiled, or it is like looped. All kinds of shapes I can have. So I can have such shapes for biopolymers like DNA, actin, and so on and so forth, and we can specify the energy of this, and that is called the worm-like chain model. So what does this model do? So let me just quickly specify the model. So the model says that if the biopolymer is straight, the energy of this biopolymer is zero. If it is curved, then the energy is proportional to the curvature. So that is the idea of this model. So this says that energy is proportional to the curvature. Now, what is the definition of a curvature? Something that we have learned in calculus, that curvature is second derivative, right? So what we have learned is that you have something like this. I can draw tangent everywhere. This is a tangent here, vectors here. And how does this tangent change is my curvature. So if I call this vector t along this curve, so let me call this as some parameter s. So here s is equal to 0, this is the and here the length. So this is the length of my polymer, DNA or actin, and here the parameter s is 0, and this is equal to s is like the contour length, so this length along the contour. So along the contour, if I go 1 nanometer, 2 nanometer, I can measure like this, and you would reach a few micron, right? So this distance along the contour is s, 0 to some micrometer, and at every s value, I can draw a tangent. So this is t as a function of s. And if this t changes, so the direction of this tangent vector changes. Here the tangent vector is this way, here the tangent vector is this way. So when the tangent vector changes, that is curvature. So the definition of the curvature is how does the tangent vector changes. So this is dt by ds. How does this tangent vector change as I go along this is defined as the curvature. So if I look at the configurations, I can draw tangent vector everywhere from a microscopic image. So I would get an image like this. I can go to every point and draw tangent vectors. And I can calculate the derivative of this tangent vectors. And then I would get the curvature. And this model says that it is not just the curvature, because if this is bent, it could be bent like this, or it could be equivalently bent like this, just exactly the same way but the opposite. So if it is bent like this or bent like this, the energy has to be the same, because how do I know, right? Because there is a symmetry. So because of this, it cannot be curvature, because this and this has different sign. The derivative has different sign. We have said that like minima and maxima in calculus we have learned. So this first derivative will have different sign for this or this. Therefore, but this and this has to have same energy. Whether I bend like this or bend like this, energy cannot be different. Therefore, this has to be at least curvature square. So this is a vector. T is a vector and dt. So this is the idea. So at every point, I can draw this curvature. I can draw tangent vectors and compute curvatures and get curvature energy. Now, I can sum all these curvature energies, and the total curvature energy I can obtain from here to here. So every point locally, I can calculate the second derivative and sum all the second derivative, this dt by ds, and I can sum them, and that is my total energy of this polymer. So in other words, this I can do some sum, which is like an integral. So I would write either an integral here. So an integral 0 to L. So this is the energy of a worm-like chain model, worm-like chain. And this is called the worm-like chain model, representing biopolymer as a curve in space, and defining energy in this particular way is called the worm-like chain model. So this is the crux of the worm-like chain model. Now, what is this proportionality constant? So let me write this now. I'm going to rub this and rewrite this. So we said that energy is proportional to the curvature whole square, and this proportionality, I have to have a proportionality constant here. This proportionality constant is called the bending stiffness. It's often written KB by 2. There is a half for some reason, which I would maybe explain another time. Same reason, similar reason as like half KX square half, because it can be written as some kind of a series expansion. And there are some reasons for this, which I wouldn't mention now, but it doesn't matter at the moment. You can think of it as a constant. And this, and there's an integral, of course. This, if I can compute this, this is the energy of a worm-like chain model, energy in the worm-like chain model. Now, given an image, I can compute this. When I write in this particular fashion, it looks slightly difficult to compute. I can convert this to a discrete form, which I am going to do this now in a minute. So let us think of some curve. Some curve like this. And I want to draw different tangent vectors at different. So I want to convert this curve to a bunch of tangent vectors. So let me call this first tangent vector t1, t2, t3, and so on and so forth. I'll have the final tangent vector here, tn. So I have n tangent vectors like this. Now, this dt by ts can be written. Like in calculus, we know that dy by dx can be written as y at x plus delta x minus y at x divided by delta x. And for small, if I fix a delta x value, I can discretize this as yi plus 1 minus yi. So for example, here I could write t2 minus t1 divided by that distance. So this is s plus delta s. So I could call this s. So for example, if I take these two points, this I could call s, and this is s plus delta s. And the difference between this is delta s, right? So I could write this same thing as, for example, in this particular case, t3 minus t2 divided by delta s. So I could write dt by ds here as dt minus ds delta s, which I would call some length b. And there is a square there, whole square. Dt by ds whole square, I could write t3 minus t2 divided by b whole square. And this would be, so if I write this as vectors, this is t3 vector square plus t2 vector square minus 2 times t3 dot t2 divided by some b square. So this if I rewrite, this is square of a vector is just the magnitude, right? If I take it as 1, what would I get? So I would get this as 1, this is 1, this says that the magnitude of the vector is just 1. I could call it b as well. So I could call it b square if I want. And this says that minus t3 dot t2. So t3 dot t2 is cos theta. And if this is 1, this would be, I would have minus 2 times cos theta. 1 plus 1 is 2. So I could write as, this could be written as 2 into 1 minus cos theta. And I could write here, I had that b here. So I would write here b, and I have this some constant here, kb, which was the constant earlier I had. So I would write that kb here. So my energy can be written as kb into divided by b times 2 into 1 minus cos theta. And I can have that half here, and I would have this cancel. So I could write this as kb by b as some new constant, which has a slightly different dimension, and then I would get this as, for if I take these two vectors, I would get this just kb by b times 1 minus cos theta. I would just write this as some new constant kb bar, let me call it kb bar because it has a different dimension, into 1 minus cos theta. So the energy of these two bonds would be kb into 1 minus cos theta, and I can take all such bonds and sum. So the total energy, I can write it as sum over I kb bar into 1 minus cos theta I. I can take all angles and sum this. Then I would get the energy. I just want to clarify that there might be a typo. So just to explain, the energy is kb dt by ds square ds integral 0 to L. So now, if I convert this, there was a kb by b square, but then there is a ds which will have a b, and those b would cancel, and you would get a kb by b sum over I 1 minus cos theta. So this I would be 1 to some n or n minus 1 depending on how you break it. So I would here 1 to n, or depending on, there would be, if you have it n vectors, there would be n minus 1 angles, and if you call it n plus 1 vectors, there would be n angles. So if there are n vectors, this would be n minus 1 angle. So that we would specify later, right? So just want to confirm that this is indeed kb by b, and the b square 1b cancels from this b in the ds, and I would get this formula, which is correct. This is the formula for the Wurmbach chain model. So what I basically showed is that if I look at contour of a polymer under a microscope, I can convert this into tangents like this and find the dot product of those two tangents, any two nearby tangents, and I would get an angle, and take cos of such an angle and sum them, I would get total energy. In other words, if I rewrite this, the energy is kb bar times sum over I 1 minus cos theta I is my energy of a worm-like chain, which is also equivalently, as I wrote, integral ds 0 to L dt by ds whole square. These two are same. Here it is kb. Kb and kb bar are essentially the same physics, same idea, but they have different dimension. So the bottom line is that if I have a configuration like this from experiment, I can calculate the vectors and the angle between those two vectors. That angle is theta, and then I can compute energy of that configuration using this particular formula. Now this KB bar is the only thing that, or the KB or KB bar is the thing that we need to know, and that represents all the molecular properties. So all the molecular properties is buried into this, and this constant is called the bending stiffness. So this is called the bending stiffness. If you remember, KB bar was KB divided by B, right? So I would just write KB bar is equal to KB divided by B, where B was the length between two discrete units. So how, if depending on how I discretize this, so B was the distance between two discrete units, depending on how I discretize it, I will have a value of B, and if I know KB, I can get KB bar. So I'm going to quickly write down the known KB of all the biomolecules that we know. So we said energy is KB divided by B, which is KB bar, sum over I 1 minus cos theta I. Now the B is, depending on how you discretize, I will get different values of B, so I can draw different vectors. So then B is essentially the distance between these two vectors, that is a B, that depending on how I draw, I will have different discretization way, and then I would get that B depending on how I draw these vectors. Now KB is the known molecular property of each biopolymer. So different biopolymers will have different KB value, and we know those values from experiments now. What we know is that, for example, KB for DNA is approximately 50 nanometer KBTR. KB is the Boltzmann constant, TR is the room temperature. So KBTR is, in the first lecture we said that KBTR is approximately 4 into 10 power minus 21 joule. So this is approximately 200, because 50 times 4, 200, and nanometer is 10 power minus 9, and 10 power minus 21 joule. So this would be 10 power minus 30 joule meter in SI unit. 200 into 10 power minus 30 joule meter. This is the bending stiffness for the DNA. Now for actin, we know that this is approximately 10 micrometer KBTR. So again, KBTR you substitute for 4 into 10 power minus 21 in SI unit joule, and 10 micrometer you multiply. For microtubule, this is of the order of millimeter. So millimeter KBTR. So millimeter is 10 power minus 3 meter, KBTR is 10 power minus 21 joule times 4, right? So I can substitute this. So I know the approximate values of this the bending stiffness, and then I can compute the energy of configurations from this. I'm going to stop this by telling a quick, simple way of actually computing energy without all the detailed calculations like this, in for a simple case which is like bending to a circle. So let us imagine, if I have a biopolymer which was like this, which was now bent to some circle like this. So if I have a biopolymer of length L, which was some bent to some circle of radius R, so L is like 2 pi R. If this is, if any polymer is bent to a circle, it turns out that the curvature is 1 by radius. It can be shown that the curvature is 1 by radius, and therefore then the energy is KB by 2 times integral, the curvature square is 1 over R square, and ds 0 to L. And this will be equal to, so since R is independent of S, doesn't matter, everywhere the same curvature, so this has to be nice circle, so I have to draw this better to a circle. In this particular case, this would, a constant, so this comes out, and 0 to L ds will become L, so this would be KB L divided by R square, and L is nothing but 2 pi R, so in other words, R can be written as L by 2 pi. So I substitute here, so KB L divided by L square and 2 pi, which is 4 pi square. So 4 pi square, and there is a KB by 2, sorry, so there is a KB by 2, so I have a KB by 2 here, there is a KB by 2 here. So what would this give me? This give me, this goes, and I would have a factor of 2 here, so I have pi square 2 KB by L. The energy is KB pi square by L, so 2 KB pi square by L, right? So now if I take L is of the order of, for DNA, if I just take DNA, and if I take L of the order of micrometer, and KB, which we said as some number, which we said 50 nanometer, so I would write, so I let me write, if we wrote 200 into 10 power minus 13 SI unit is the KB, pi square is about 10, so this is another 20 divided by L, which I would call as micrometer, 10 power minus 6. So if I substitute here, what am I getting? So 200 into 2, 400, 4000. So 4000 and 10 power minus 30 would come to be about, so let me write it here, 4000 into 10 power minus 30, and there is the 6, so I would write it as 10 power minus 24, and this I would write it as 4 into 10 power minus 21 joule. So basically this energy, what is this? Energy to bend of DNA to a circle. If I take a 1 micrometer DNA piece and if I bend to a circle, the energy is 4 into 10 power minus 21 joule approximately. What does that mean? That means that this is comparable to the thermal energy. So this is comparable to the thermal energy. In other words, thermal energies can bend DNAs of the order of micrometer to circles. They have that much power, enough energy to actually coil DNA. So this gives us some reason to think and understand why DNA inside a nucleus is coiled up, because this thermal energy will make it coiled, because they are powerful enough to kick and bend the DNA to curves of various. So if you look under a microscope, or if you look under a cell, like DNA would be like all kinds of shape. Of course, protein plays a very important role in shaping the DNA, but even if you take in vitro, put DNA in water at room temperature, they would be coiled. And thermal energy is powerful enough to bend long DNAs into coils if the length is of the order of micrometer or above. Now, interestingly, this kind of same idea can be applied to any biopolymers. You think about for actin and other microtubules from the numbers we said, This idea can be also extended to study membranes and other 2D membrane. Instead of a polymer, it becomes a 2D sheet, but the curvature, this 1 over r radius as the curvature, etc., can be extended to study membranes, which I wouldn't discuss in this course, but you can use this physical idea and understand how people think about energy of a membrane and so on and so forth, the curvature energy of a membrane. So in this particular lecture, I would stop here. What, just to summarize what we did was, we computed energy of a biopolymer from, by looking at its configuration. Okay, this is of course easily applicable if you look at biopolymers in vitro. In vivo, there are proteins, which makes things more complicated. We have not accounted for protein. We just looked at its configurations, and if the configuration is this, and if I know the KB, I can have the bending energy or the energy of that configurations based on this worm-like chain model. We'll stop here. Thank you.